So maybe you've been riding for a while and you've explored basically all the good roads around you for 100 miles and you're looking for something a little different. Or maybe you just want to get out and see the world from the saddle of your motorcycle, because driving through the painted desert is one thing in your car, but on a bike, it's a whole other experience. There's something about traveling the open road on a motorcycle that's very alluring to riders and normies alike, but chances are you're not going to want to crush big miles on your super sport. Not only will your back be on fire before you're through your first tank of gas, but your wrists will be in pain and your butt will be sore from the plywood they use to make the seat out of. They make a whole bunch of motorcycles that can mosey down the highway all day and leave you feeling fresh enough to hit a twisty road when you get where you're going, and they're not all crazy expensive or giant dadmobiles or even goofy looking adventure bikes. If you're looking to pick up a motorcycle you can travel on, I've assembled a list of 9 motorcycles I would buy, featuring one from basically every manufacturer. There are some that didn't make the list because, let's face it, ain't no one touring on an MV, and no one knows where to buy a Moto Guzzi in America. They're gonna run the gambit from styles and prices, but there should be something out there for everyone to enjoy. But before we jump in though, I wanted to take a quick second and thank all the folks supporting us on YammieNoob.co. It's because of folks like them that we get to give away motorcycles and have such an awesome Discord server. If you're looking for a place to hang out with other motorcyclists from around the world, this is the best place to do it. We've got channels for buying and selling gear, troubleshooting issues with your bike, or just posting memes. That, and you can chat with Yammie and myself because we're on there all the time. Click the link down below and join the best community for motorcyclists on the internet, and get entered to win some free bikes at the same time over on YammieNoob.co. Number 1, the Honda Goldwing. Come on, you knew it was going to be on here. It's the king of the highway. Literally no other motorcycle on the planet cruises like a Goldwing. They've been making them forever, and at this point they're so advanced they're basically cars on 2 wheels. The wings come in 3 different flavors. You have your base model at $23,800, the Goldwing Tour at $27,500, and the Tour Airbag at $32,300. They all feature an 1,833cc flat 6, which for those of you who don't know is basically like a boxer engine, but with 3 cylinders on either side. It's putting down 98 horsepower and 108 foot-pounds of torque, which is more than enough to get its 838-pound self up to highway speeds and cruise all day. As you go up in price, you also go up in features, with the touring version packing a top box, integrated passenger backrest, USB ports and saddlebags, and a few other goodies for the passenger. All models do come with a big old navigation screen, 1,000 different control buttons, adjustable windscreens, a bunch of little different compartments, and fog lights on the engine. The best part about the Goldwing is it can actually corner, unlike certain other motorcycles I won't Harley Davidson name. Is it worth the same price as a mid-level sedan? Yeah, it really is. There's a reason why you see so many old Goldwings on the road, and that's because they literally never die. Number 2, the KTM 1290 Super Adventure. This is probably the dumbest motorcycle on this list. Someone over in Austria showed up to work one day and decided they wanted to take the fire-breathing 1301cc 75-degree V-twin from the Super Duke and chuck it into a motorcycle that could go off-road, because of course you have to have 180 horsepower and 108 foot-pounds of torque to navigate a gravel road. But what they really succeeded in doing was creating a spectacular sport touring motorcycle. If you're planning on hitting a trail, but your trail just so happens to be on the other side of the road of bones, this might be the bike to take with you. The engine is completely bananas. We've actually got a video coming out about the Super Duke later this week, so stay tuned for that. But when it comes to the Super Adventure, what else are you getting? Well, if you go with the S model, you get cast wheels, adjustable windscreen, heated grips, cruise control, coffee maker, giant TFT display, so both you and the people driving next to you can see exactly how fast you're going, electronically adjustable WP suspension, and the list goes on. What's nuts is that it'll only cost you $18,599, but this bike can absolutely shred a corner and keep you warm and comfy while it does it. The R version is more off-road oriented with crash bars and spoked wheels, so just pick the one that suits your riding style a little bit better and go with that one. They're all the same price. Next up, the Indian Challenger. Yep, not a Harley today because I wanted to keep you all on your toes. The Challenger is Indian's answer to the Road Glide from Harley, and it's a solid, albeit goofy looking attempt to break free of Harley's stranglehold on the cruiser marketplace. The new Challengers are liquid-cooled, which means that it's putting out similar torque figures to the Road Glide at 113 foot-pounds of torque, but it's making 103 horsepower, which makes it a bit quicker up top. Indian claims a dry weight of 805 pounds, but with a 6-gallon gas tank and a stonkin' great 1768cc engine, it's probably pushing closer to 860 or even 870 pounds. We all know that American cruisers are good for long-distance rides, but what makes the Indian special is that it's actually pretty good in a corner. It's packing 43mm upside-down front forks and dual-disc Brembos up front. It's got more ground clearance than the Harley, but you're still going to be scraping hard parts sooner than you like. But hey, a few extra degrees of lean is always a good thing. Personally, I'm not a fan of the layout of the Batwing fairing, nor am I a fan of the headlight. I prefer the classic looks of the Harley, and the Harley's a little bit cheaper before you start adding parts, but I can't deny the quality and modernity of the new Indian power plants. Number 4 is our entry from Suzuki, and for this one I picked none other than the Hayabusa. Now, I know you're rolling your eyes right now, thinking that I picked this one just for the memes, and while I do love spending my time working by Googling pictures of wretched Hayabusas, it's actually really good on a highway. The modern Busas have power modes, ABS, fully adjustable suspension, and Brembos, which make it a little bit better and more livable than something like the Gen 1 Busa we have in the shop. There's also a handful of things that you can do to a Busa to make it more comfortable, since it is a little bit lean forward for my liking. First, you should definitely get a set of bar risers, which make the reach to the bars a little less extreme, and next you're going to need a better seat, because that's always a great way to improve a ride. The last thing you're going to need to do is you're going to need to run out and pick up a turbocharger, because unfortunately the 1340cc engine just doesn't feel as potent up top, and you really need that extra punch to pass on the highway. Jokes aside, the Busa is actually a really good sport touring machine, and while the modern version isn't as crazy as the old one, it's still an ungodly fast and unkillable motorcycle. Number 5 from Yamaha, we have the Nikon.
That ain't no motorcycle, that one's one of them trike-a-majiggers.
I know what you're thinking, why would I pick something so goofy when Yamaha's got the Tenere 700, the MT-10, or even the big Star cruising bikes? Well, first of all, it's packing the 847cc triple from the FZ09, which is just as rowdy and fun as ever, and it's got bags as standard on the GT package. But the real reason it's so good at tackling big miles is down to the front end. The two 15-inch wheels create a ton of rotational inertia to keep the bike online very easily. Also, that big front end gives you plenty of wind protection, though the screen is not adjustable for some reason, and that's kind of an oversight on a bike that's meant to do big highway miles. It might not look like it, but believe it or not, the Nikon is actually really competent in a corner and can handle basically anything you throw at it. It's got a solid technology suite baked in, from a quick shifter to adjustable traction control, rider modes, and it can wheelie, which is really nice. If you're thinking about getting a big mile bike and thought that the Nikon was just a stupid looking thought experiment, you owe it to yourself to give it another look. Next up, from the Kyle of motorcycle manufacturers, Kawasaki, we have something so silly that Graham Chapman might come back from the grave just to put a stop to it. The H2SX. Because what's better than a Turbo Hayabusa? A supercharged Ninja, of course. Admittedly, this one's a bit of a unicorn, since you can't actually buy them new anymore, or at least not in America, it seems. But if you can get your mitts on this bike, you're in for A, some super comfy ergonomics, B, bleeding edge electronics, and C, horsepower and torque that'll snap your head back. It's got a 998cc inline 4, putting down 197 horsepower and 101 foot-pounds of torque, and it's supercharged, and it does this weird little chirp when you get off the throttle, since the impeller actually spins faster than the speed of sound. If you're worried about getting a sport touring motorcycle and all your friends calling it a dad bike, then this overcompensation on two wheels will surely shut them up. It looks like a cross between the H2 and the ZX14, and it does come in at a porky 594 pounds. Most normal people out there will be happy with something like the Versus 1000 with its paltry 118 horsepower, but for the true mad lads out there, there's a more elegant choice. Whether you're crossing the Continental Divide or outrunning a police helicopter, there's basically no better motorcycle. But now let's cleanse our palates with something a little bit more refined, the Ducati Supersport. But Spike, you said you can't crush big miles on a Supersport. I'm corn fuzzed. Well, the Supersport is not actually a Supersport, as infuriating as that might sound. For some reason, Ducati saw fit to take the Panigale, the Supersport, and relax the ergonomics significantly, tune the engine for street duty, and then give it saddlebags as a factory option, and then for some maddening reason, they called it the Supersport. And that right there is why Ducati is big dumb. But anyway, the Supersport is perhaps the most sporting motorcycle on this list. Sure, it's comfy enough for you to spend an entire day on, but you could also take this to a track all day. It's packing fully adjustable Marzocchi suspension and Ohlins if you spring for the S package, which is only $15,395. It's packing in the 937cc V-twin engine, putting down 110 horsepower and 69 foot-pounds of torque, which, yeah, might not sound like a lot compared to the other motorcycles on this list, but trust me when I say this bike is plenty fast. If you want to tackle big miles but also look damn fine while you do it, the Supersport is your bike of choice. But what about BMW? Surely I would have to pick the GS, right? The bike that made it around the world. Well, first off, no. The new GS and Ewan and Charlie's GSs have basically nothing in common. And secondly, they made a better sport tourer in the S1000 XR. It's a classic BMW with a 999.999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999 park just as it was designed to, no more and no less. It features cold, calculating electronics because personality and character are meaningless in the search of perfection. It has no flaws and will never leave you high and dry. But you will be a BMW boy, so there is that. But hey, you'll get a gear credit when you pick it up, so you can trade in your Dainese gear for a BMW jacket and get a shoe berth helmet with a BMW logo on it. Buying a BMW is a lot like joining the Borg, but hey, different strokes for different folks, right? At least it'll only cost you $17,945. Wait a minute. That's actually a lot of money. Maybe you should just get a GS. Whoa, never mind. That one starts at $22,000. Goddamn. Lastly, let's bring this one to a close with a British offering. Triumph's Street Scrambler. That one's kind of an odd duck, since it's not a full-on scrambler, though it can tackle a trail, and it's not as sporty as a bike like the Thruxton, but it can handle a twisty road. The bike's an excellent cruiser with its 900cc engine putting down 65 horsepower and the same number of torque. What makes this bike so good is its engine. It's torquey yet smooth, meaning it doesn't vibrate as you plod along the highway at 70 miles an hour in fifth gear, which is basically just an overdrive, and you can let the highway miles just melt away. The seat is nice and wide, and the foot pegs are somewhere between a standard and a cruiser foot position, which makes it feel like you're sitting in a chair. It's got a great sound down to its 270-degree crank, and hey, that's pretty good for $11,000. But you could win one for free if you click the link below and head over to YammieNoob.co and get yourself signed up. That would technically make it the cheapest bike on this list. Food for thought. Fact, on Good Friday in 1930, the BBC reported there is no news, and instead they just played a bunch of piano music.
Oh, hey, you're still here. I can't believe you made it to the end of the video. Not many people do. Just for you, I have a little treat. Hit this link over here, check out the next video on the Yammie Noob catalog. What's gonna happen in it? I don't really know. Maybe there's a boost in it, maybe there's some cool wheelies, maybe there's some fun memes. Probably. Who can say?